I was looking at the arrow, like, there's a house.
Yeah, but can you get to it off of five? Well, I thought you'd go around.
In my comments, I said, there is a house on it.
I don't know.
You see,
I tell you, taking everything away from your hands.
Michelle, are we ready?
Give me a minute.
Okay. Amy, just give us a few minutes before we get started.
Yeah, see, this guy.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the November 9th, 2017, St. Mary's County Board of Appeals hearing. Before we get started, there's a sign-in sheet outside the door if you're speaking this evening. Also, there's one for people attending tonight in case further information needs to be sent to you regarding any of our cases. And we'll start with the introduction of our board to my left.
Stuart Egley, alternate.
Wayne Madensky.
John Brown.
George Allen Hayden.
Sandy Greenstaff.
Ronald Payne.
William Green.
David Weisskopf, County Attorney.
Yvonne Chalet, Zoning Administrator.
And for the record, we have Mr. Hunt, the Director of Land Use and Growth Management, in the audience as well. We have one case this evening. It's a variance request, VAAP number 17-1447, the Cullison property. Ms. Chalet, have we gotten the certified mailing receipt for this?
Yes, staff exhibit one was submitted to the recording secretary, and that included the proof of ad, the certified mail receipts, and the certification of property posting and mailing.
Okay, so, and before you give us your legal description and present the case this evening, I'd like to swear you in, if you would, please. Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony, responses, and statements you may give would be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
Thank you. You may start. Yes.
The applicants request a variance from section 71.8.3 of the Comprehensive Zoning Ordinance to disturb the critical area buffer to construct a single-family dwelling. The property owners are Mark and Dana Cullison, who are the applicants. Mr. Bob Troutman is their surveyor and is here representing them tonight. The property is located at 16406 Ball Point Road in Piney Point, on tax map 69, grid 9, parcel 247 in the 9th Election District. The property is 7,736 square feet in size. It is zoned Rural Preservation District with a limited development area, critical area designation. The property and the variance request were advertised in the Enterprise on October 25th and November 1st, 2017. The agenda was posted online along with the staff report and accompanying documents last week, November 2nd. The property is in a critical area. It is not waterfront. It is on Ball Point Road. It is a grandfathered lot, though, in a critical area because it was recorded prior to the adoption of the critical area regulations on December 1st, 1985. The property is constrained by the critical area buffer, which has been expanded to include the Othello soils, which are hydric soils. According to the site plan provided by Mr. Troutman, the existing lot coverage consists of 1,087 square feet, and that is because there is a driveway across the property, and that driveway actually goes across this property to meet up with the property behind it. The new lot coverage consists of the proposed single-family dwelling, a modest expansion of the driveway, and the steps leading to and from the proposed deck. The allowed amount of lot coverage on a property of this size is 2,434 square feet, or 25% plus 500 square feet. So of the existing lot coverage on the property, 825 square feet is in the buffer. The proposed amount of lot coverage in the buffer is 607 square feet, for a total of 1,432 square feet of lot coverage in the buffer. And that is a 607 square foot increase in what currently exists. The property is within special flood hazard area zone AE. The property must be, the house must be elevated. And this is AE6, meaning the base flood elevation is 6 feet. And so the property, the house must be elevated to 3 feet above the 6 feet. So the first floor of the house needs to be at an elevation of 9 feet. A private well and a public sewer system serve the property. Approximately 3,000 square feet of woodland and other vegetation covers the property, which is 42% of the property. The applicants plan to clear only 400 square feet of this, which is 12.5% of the existing vegetation. And the applicants will be required to mitigate for the new lot coverage and disturbance in the buffer. The Soil Conservation District approved the site plan, as well as the Health Department. The Health Department approved it on October 20th, 2017. Metropolitan Commission approved it for the sewer on September 28th, 2017. The Critical Area Commission did review the variance proposal, and the Critical Area Commission has no comments, really. They don't oppose the variance, and their comment letter is attached to the staff report. If the variance is granted, the applicants have 1 year from the date the order is signed to obtain their permit and begin construction. The standards for granting a variance in the critical area are listed in the staff report, and what staff believes the board has to determine in order to find that the applicants have met each standard. And that concludes my staff report, and I would like to enter the staff report as Exhibit 2 along with the attachments into the record.
Thank you, Ms. Chalet. Does anyone have any questions for Ms. Chalet?
No.
Okay. Mr. Tribman, you represent Mr. Collisons?
Yes, sir.
Okay, you up.
Pardon?
You up.
I'm up. Okay.
Let me get you sworn in there before you get started then. Do you declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony's responses and statements you may give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, this lot is very small. It does have... It has been grandfathered in, and as such, the Critical Area Commission has not opposed this at all. We have approvals from MedCom, the Health Department, Soil Conservation, and all the agencies, and we're just waiting for you guys to come up. The reason we're here is because of the swamp and the marsh is right there across the road on the southwest side of the property. The 100-foot buffer itself takes up 3/4 of it. Then the soil just go on and clean on down. So we have nowhere else to build.
Okay.
The property is the property, of course, is served by a private well and a public sewer system. We will be doing a buffer management plan to replace those trees in the coverage, the amount of 1,200 square feet. The outside dimensions of the house are only about 936 square feet in total, so the house is not going to be that big, but we're going to do the best we can with what we have. And I think that we're going to be about 10 feet off the ground with it, so there'll be plenty high above the floodplain. We'll have no problem there at all. Flooding should be not no problem whatsoever. I think everything else has been said that we need to cover in this particular, not much else. It's right. Small, that's the point, and nowhere else to go.
Okay.
Any questions?
Thanks. Anybody have any questions for Mr. Tribman?
Is it a two-story house or?
Sir?
Two-story house or just one?
Yes, two-story, yes. I mean, we're already going to be up 10 feet.
Right.
And then we're going to have two more stories.
Two more stories. And the deck, what elevation?
There's a sufficient, there's a substantial deck around it, as you've shown on the drawing on three sides there. And that will give a real nice view of the waters about, because you'll be overlooking all the homes there.
Is that on top of the first story?
It's at the first floor level.
Or is it the base level or the?
No, 10 foot up.
10 foot?
First floor will be 10 foot off the ground.
Right.
Yeah, and then the deck will be there.
And it's not going to be at the second floor level?
I don't think that's what we proposed, no.
You can't tell. I was just wondering.
Do you know how much square footage it is?
936 square feet.
How much?
936 square feet on the per floor.
Oh, my goodness, so much square footage. That's another case we had.
So the remaining 1,087 square feet, that's for the driveway?
The driveway and the steps and, the road.
House itself.
Pardon?
The house itself.
Yeah, of course, the house itself, yes.
The house is 936, right?
Yes.
And so the balance is driveway and steps?
Driveways, yes. Because we're going to have to be parking between the driveway that leads to the rear and the house. So it's got to be wide so we get, we don't have any length to it.
So both floors, 936?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Any other questions? Okay. Thank you, Mr. Trautman. We open up public testimony? Seeing anyone want to speak on this case this evening? Seeing none, we'll close public testimony. Any comments from the board? Any discussion?
Just about the deck. Is that included in the square footage?
No.
No, it's not.
Right, no. And staff, the environmental planner who reviewed this and will approve it, there will be a note placed on the approved site plan that says spacing, there must be spacing between the deck boards to allow water to flow, and then it doesn't count as lot coverage.
Is that a quarter of an inch?
But it's also, excuse me, I'm sorry.
Is that a quarter of an inch of how much space?
No more than a quarter of an inch is required. But this deck is already elevated. 10 feet, Mr. Trautman, I believe you said, was the first floor, but actually?
Yeah, the first floor, yes.
So it's not really lot coverage, even if it doesn't have spacing.
And I believe the rule was that if it folds down, it does not touch the ground, that allows.
It used to be a one-to-one ratio, the height of the deck versus.
I didn't realize that.
I didn't either. I learned something new tonight.
Yeah, that's the first I'd heard of that.
I guess I missed it. Repeat that again on the ratio?
I don't believe it's in the law now, but we did have, there was a regulation in state law that if there was a one-to-one ratio between the height of the deck from the ground and the depth of the deck, then it did not count as lot coverage, even if it were solid.
Okay.
But in this instance, they're putting spacing between the deck boards, so it's not an issue.
I think haven't we heard this case before?
This one?
Yes.
No.
Several years ago.
Not that I know of.
Okay, I remember one.
Similar?
Yeah, and I thought it was the same one coming back again.
Nearly every development in St. George Island requires a variance.
Yep. Any other questions?
No.
Okay. Then, just simple comments from myself. I think it's a very modest request. And again, this is unusual, but the critical area didn't even oppose this one at all. So, and all the other the soil conservation approves it as well, health department, so I think it's a very modest request.
Yeah, there's no place else for them to build.
Right, right. And the lot is, kind of dictates where you have to build. So I don't have an issue with this request at all, so.
So I'll make a motion to, in the matter of VAAP number 17-1447, Cullison property, having made a finding that the standards for granting a variance in the critical area and the objectives of section 71-8-3 of the St. Mary's County Comprehensive Zoning Ordinance have been met, I move to approve the variance request to disturb the critical area buffer to construct a single-family dwelling.
Have a motion on the floor?
Second.
And we'll start with Mr. Green.
Oh, yes.
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 Okay. Mr. Tribman, you've heard the board's discussion and their decision this evening on your case. The unanimous decision to support the request. So, an order reflecting the board's decision will be prepared by staff and signed by the board within 30 days. A 30-day period follows from the date the order is signed on which any aggrieved party may appeal this board's decision in circuit court. Any action taken that time will be at your own risk, and we'll send you a copy of the order once it's signed.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Have a good evening.
Thank you very much.
We've got a couple other things here. Order of business. Did everyone have the opportunity to take a look at the minutes from last meeting?
Yes.
Yes.
Is there any additions, corrections, deletions that need to be done?
None that I see.
Then can I have a motion to approve the minutes and for me to sign them?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. And we have two orders this evening. The first order is the Swan property in Hollywood. And there was a variance request to disturb a critical buffer to replace a single-family dwelling. And there was five voting members that night, and we all voted to support that request. Just need a motion so I can sign the order.
I'll make a motion to sign the order.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you. The other one was the appeal of the Planning Commission for the Woods at Myrtle Point, sections 2, 4, 5, and 6. And there were five members voting that night. All five voted to support the request that evening. Then there was a condition that the approval of section 6 of the property is conditioned upon section 6 being rezoned from RL-T to RL prior to obtaining final site plan approval. And I just need a motion to sign this one.
I move.
And second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. Michelle, do we have anything on agenda for next month?
No, we do not.
Okay. So as of...
There isn't time to schedule anything.
There's no time, so...
Apply for anything recently.
So we will not have a meeting in December?
There's no need. Unless, how about signing an order?
I have to prepare the order that was today, right?
Right.
Unless
George, in the past, I'm sorry, Mr. Peter. In the past, the board has been able to authorize you to sign an order outside the public hearing. And I believe if Mr. Weisskopf emails you the orders and everyone provides
feedback.
Yes, but they have to make a motion
right
tonight to authorize if you want to do that.
That'll save everyone a trip here for next month, because we're not going to be able to, there's two, we don't have any time to put in cases on the agenda, so if that's, if everyone's okay with me reviewing the order once it's prepared and signing, and I just need a motion for that tonight. And to be honest with you, it's a very minor order on this one, so. Any discussion?
No, no, I'm good with that.
I'm good.
Then I just need a motion.
So moved. Okay, move that the chairman be authorized to sign the order for the, which case is it?
Right here.
Okay, for the Cullison Property Board of Appeals hearing case that we heard tonight, 17-1447.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. The other point of business that we may have here is that tonight is probably the night, the last night for Mr. Payne to be serving on the board. His term ends. And if I'm not mistaken, he served as a member for 6 years, and prior to that, 4 years as an alternate.
Yes.
Am I correct?
That's correct.
So I'd just like to thank you for your time served here, and we appreciate every meeting that you've been at, and all the comments that you've made, and support that you've given to the board, to the county, and to the applicants. So it's been a big deal. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yep. Anyone else?
Well, I would like to thank Mr. Payne also, and one thing I will always remember was during a cell tower presentation, he asked the question, at what point will we have a cell tower next to every mailbox? And I think it kind of stimulated the discussion.
So, anyway.
You know, the hayride has to end sooner or later.
It's been a pleasure to serve with.
Everybody has a great time on a hayride.
Yes.
And I would like to thank the board and staff, and especially Mr. Hayden and Mr. Madinsky, two guys that I've served with on two separate occasions, and very, to me, quality guys. And they do a great job up here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And it's been a pleasure serving with you as well. Anything else?
I'll take this opportunity to wish everybody here and everybody at home a happy Thanksgiving.
Yep.
Happy Thanksgiving to all, and also a one-day belated birthday to Mr.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Gotcha.
So, okay. Anything else?
Nope.
I'm hoping for a motion for adjournment.
I move we adjourn.
Mr. Payne, you give a second to that?
A second.
Thank you so much.